Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is a statement by Shona Robison on the Penrose inquiry. The Cabinet Secretary will take questions at the end of her statement, and there should therefore be no interventions or interruptions. I call on Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary, around 10 minutes.
Presiding Officer, I am grateful for the opportunity to make a statement in response to the Penrose inquiry report, which was laid in Parliament yesterday. I would like to thank Lord Penrose and his team for their work. Lord Penrose is currently unwell, and this has prevented him from launching the inquiry report in person yesterday, and my thoughts are with him and his family. I would also like to personally thank affected patients and their families for providing evidence of a very personal and sensitive nature, which cannot have been easy, and I would want to recognise that some of them have joined us in the gallery today. The affected patients and their families must be foremost in our minds today. I met some of those who have been affected yesterday and I heard their stories. Many people have died or suffered long-term disability and hardship as a result of these infections. Relatives have had to sacrifice careers to provide care and support. In some cases, partners and loved ones have themselves become infected. Patients, families and carers have dealt with these difficulties with immense enduring courage. Although these events took place well before this Parliament was ever established, on behalf of the Government of Scotland and the NHS in Scotland, I want to say sorry to everyone who has had to deal with the devastating impact of infected NHS blood and blood products. And I want to recognise that these events absolutely amount to one of the greatest healthcare-related tragedies ever witnessed in this country. We must keep the people who have been affected at the centre of our thoughts throughout this process. I can only express my deepest sympathy and regret to them. Lord Penrose has delivered a comprehensive report of almost 1,800 pages. It is a detailed and independent assessment of how these tragic events unfolded. I realise that there may be some criticism of the cost and length of time that is taken for the inquiry to report its findings. I'm also very aware that for many, the inquiry conclusions do not meet their expectations and the outcomes that they would have wished to see. These were complex issues covering a long period of time back to 1974. In light of the number of people affected, the number of people who have died, and given the seriousness of these events, the people who were affected have now had the opportunity to have their stories heard by a fully independent public inquiry. Turning to the findings, the evidence from affected patients is crucial. Lord Penrose sets this out in full within his report. It stands as vital, if distressing, testimony as to what affected patients and their families have endured. The report has provided estimates of the number of patients likely to have been infected. These add to what we know already, and they allow us to be more certain about the scale of the impact of these events. Lord Penrose also identified delays to the introduction of hepatitis C screening in Scotland as a key thing that could have been done differently. Screening in Scotland was held back so that it could be introduced simultaneously across the UK. Clearly, these events predate devolution. This would simply not happen now. There are other things to learn about the approach of clinicians and healthcare staff, about the way the health service works, the importance of patient safety, and how that relates to expert advice. In particular, Penrose makes certain observations about the NHS's paternalistic attitude to patients in the 1980s, particularly in relation to patients being given information. This is not the way the NHS in Scotland works now, and Penrose himself acknowledges that the approach to patients today is very different. All of these lessons from Penrose will instruct how we continue to build on the progress of our patient safety programme. Lord Penrose recommends that the Scottish Government should take all reasonable steps to offer a hepatitis C test to anybody who might have been infected before 1991 by a blood transfusion and who has not already been diagnosed. We accept this recommendation and we will consider carefully how to take this forward. It is important to reassure people that we have previously made efforts to find those who have been infected, including a look-back exercise in 1995 and awareness-raising campaigns as late as 2008. We expect that there will be very few people, if any, who were infected with a blood transfusion and who have not been diagnosed by now. However, Anyone who wants to know more will be able to find information on the NHS Inform website or from organisations such as Hepatitis Scotland, Haemophilia Scotland and the Scottish Infected Blood Forum. There is no barrier to hepatitis C testing in Scotland. Anyone who has been exposed via blood transfusion before September 1991 or by treatment for a bleeding disorder with blood products prior to May 1987 can be tested at their GP practice. It's important that anyone who has been infected is diagnosed so they can access the best clinical care and support. When talking about clinical care, I should also take the opportunity to make clear our current blood safety record is excellent and the risks of viral transmission by blood transfusion in Scotland and the UK are exceedingly low. Donor selection criteria, stringent testing of blood donations and advances in technology mean that the blood supply is as safe as it can be. It is safe to give blood and it's safe to receive blood. Presiding Officer, I want to talk about the further steps that we'll now take to support those who have been affected. There are two payment schemes for those infected with hepatitis C, which the Scottish Government contributes directly to. The Skipton Fund, which provides lump sum and annual payments, and the Caxton Foundation, which provides discretionary payments to affected people and dependents. Over the last 10 years, the Scottish Government has already contributed over £30 million to these funds for affected people in Scotland. Separately, there are payment schemes which predate devolution for those infected with HIV. These are managed by the UK Department of Health. It's right to acknowledge that many patients and their families are of the view that the payments they receive are insufficient. This view is reflected in the Penrose report. We've already committed to reviewing these schemes and we'll now move ahead with that. Given the two HIV support schemes predate devolution and are managed by the UK Department of Health, we will work with the other UK countries to take forward this review. I recognise that the UK Department of Health yesterday announced a one-off payment of £25 million to support any transitional arrangements to a different payment system. We will, of course, ensure that any required contribution from Scotland will be met in 2015-16. We must resolve this issue as quickly as possible, and I'll be going into this review with a view that we should be able to conclude our work in time to make an announcement by no later than World Haemophilia Day in April 2016. I'm also of the view that we must listen to the view of affected patients. I had the opportunity to hear from affected families yesterday, and it's very clear to me we have to improve the system. In Scotland, we'll be establishing a patients and families reference group to help us with the review of these schemes. I also want to say a few words about the work that we've been doing and will continue to do with patients and families and the organisations which support them, such as Haemophilia Scotland and the Scottish Infected Blood Forum. I met with representatives from these organisations over the past few weeks and again today, and both have provided suggestions of various actions that we can take forward. We've already funded the Scottish Infected Blood Forum to carry out a scoping exercise to investigate the support needs of those affected, and this will contribute to the evidence base for the review of the financial schemes. We're separately working with Haemophilia Scotland to develop a pilot of additional social work support for affected people. We also have funded a pilot of additional psychological support to affected patients through one of the haemophilia centres in Scotland, and I'm committed to successful completion of this pilot and to learn any lessons for what additional support we can provide generally. I can also confirm that a national managed clinical network, essentially a haemophilia committee, will be established for inherited bleeding disorders. This will closely involve patients and help improve clinical services for the future. Finally, both Haemophilia Scotland and the Scottish Infected Blood Forum do vital work in supporting the affected patients and their families. So I'm pleased to confirm today that the Scottish Government will commit to providing core funding for both organisations for the next 3 years to ensure that they can continue their good work. I've asked today both organisations to help establish the reference group to help take forward the Penrose recommendation, the other actions I've highlighted and the consultation on the review of the financial schemes. We'll also be more than happy to discuss providing support to any other organisations who work with affected patients and their families. Presiding Officer, the conclusion of the Penrose inquiry is a watershed moment. We can now say with some certainty that we understand how this tragedy unfolded. People who have been affected have now had the opportunity to be heard and to put on record what happened as part of an independent public inquiry. But I want to finish by reiterating how sorry I am that these infections happen through NHS treatment. I have great sympathy to all those affected and will continue to work closely with and offer support to them in any way that we can. The Penrose Inquiry was looking at what has happened, but we must now focus on better supporting those affected going forward. In doing so, I can promise that we will continue to listen to them and work with them. I recognise that this statement will not immediately fulfil the desires of all those who have been affected, but I hope my comments reflect the Scottish Government's intention and my intention to move forward and work with patients and their families in the coming years.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. The Cabinet Secretary will now take questions on issues raised in her statement. I intend to allow around 20 minutes for questions, after which we move on to next business. If any member wishes to ask a question of the Cabinet Secretary, please press your request button, speak button now. And I call Jenny Mara.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I add the sympathies of these benches to the remarks made by the Cabinet Secretary just a few moments ago and thank her for an advance copy of her statement? The Penrose Inquiry, published yesterday, laid bare the full horror of the blood contamination that led to so many lives being lost and devastated by hepatitis C and HIV. The testimony of the victims in the report and the stories we heard from those who attended yesterday's event were nothing short of harrowing. Bill Wright, Chair of Haemophilia Scotland, described the blood contamination episode as one of the most distressing stories in the history of the NHS. And it is difficult, Presiding Officer, to argue with his analysis. He, like many others, was disappointed, as the Cabinet Secretary said, with the findings in the report. The most commonly used description of the report by families yesterday was whitewash. Parliament and government do not have any say over the findings of the report, but we can take the opportunity to put things right for many patients. With this inquiry now over, can the Scottish Government ensure that new and improved treatments which are being developed for hepatitis C are made available for the victims of this dreadful episode as soon as possible? And given the First Minister stood shoulder to shoulder with the victims, first as opposition leader and as Health Secretary, now that she is First Minister and the six-year inquiry she ordered is over, will her government now make good on the commitments for financial support? Because as the Cabinet Secretary has just announced that financial support will be made available by April next year, but after waiting 6 years for this inquiry to report, is it not reasonable that the Scottish Government make good that commitment to victims now and put financial support in place without any more delay? I think it is unfair to ask victims to wait yet another year when they have waited so long and the Government has had so long to prepare for this day.
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I first of all say that, of course, anyone who requires treatment through the new drugs and is clinically approved and recommended for treatment through the new Hep C drugs, of course, should receive that. First Minister said earlier on behalf of the Scottish Government, an apology for what had happened, and I think it's important we recognise that. Jenny Mara talked about what Bill Wright and others have said, but if she had listened to what Bill Wright and others had said, she would have heard Bill Wright say that he wanted to sit down through the reference group and discuss what the proper support should be, that they want to be involved in the review of the financial arrangements. That call has come from those who have been affected, and therefore I think Jenny Mara should understand the view of the patients and campaigners on this matter, that actually they want to talk to us about what those financial arrangements should be. So it's in listening to Bill Wright and others that we've come to the conclusions today that I laid out in my statement, that the reference group would be established, a proper forum for discussing those matters. It was Bill Wright himself that asked for World Haemophilia Day to be the point in time by which these new arrangements should be put in place. So I very much do listen to the views of those affected. I have done over the last few years, and I sat on the Health Committee and listened to the first round of evidence on this, and I have met with Bill Wright and others over many, many years, and over the last few weeks, and indeed today. So I will absolutely listen to those voices as we take this forward.
Jackson Carlow.
Thank you. Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of her statement, and can I associate the Scottish Conservatives entirely with the sentiments that she has expressed? Can I also thank the First Minister for having the courage to initiate the inquiry, and to say that I'm actually quietly proud that it was the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament that in fact initiated the inquiry that took place. I have three very brief points. One, I would like to associate myself too with the approach that the Cabinet Secretary has taken in relation to the response to the relatives and others affected. It is important that I think through our actions we are able to counteract through practical approach any characterisation of the report as a whitewash. It's easy to understand why some might say that. I don't characterise it that way myself, and I support the action she's taken. Can I ask her when she does expect to be able in her own mind as a timeline to advise us on what further actions she thinks might arise as a result of the consideration of the recommendation that's taken place? And can I also ask her in relation to the HIV compensation, just to confirm that she will act with the Westminster Government to ensure that the implementation of the provisions of that are as smooth as possible?
Cabinet Secretary.
Just on the last point first, then, of course, obviously the general election being in the time frame that it is, that some of these discussions with the Westminster Government will obviously have to take place after the 7th of May, but we obviously want to have those discussions as soon thereafter. Can I also, I think, thank Jackson Carlow for his comments. This has been a very long inquiry, and I very much recognise that the families and those affected have waited a long time for what happened yesterday, and we should bear that in mind. He is also right to say that action is important, and it's not about looking back, it's about looking forward. The work on the reference group, when I met with some of those affected in campaign groups earlier on, they were keen to get that work underway, and so am I. So the reference group discussions will happen in short order, and thereafter they will decide on the priorities going forward. Some of that is about the review of the financial arrangements, but there are also other things we can get on with quite quickly, in my view, particularly around things like the psychological and social work supports that many have said need to be improved. So I would like to get on with those in short order, and I will certainly be keen and happy to keep Parliament updated on the progress of that.
Christine Graham.
Oh, I beg your pardon, Presiding Officer. I commend to the Cabinet Secretary, Robert Mackey, a constituent of mine who many of us will remember sat with others outside the old Parliament and All Weathers campaigning for an inquiry, and I commend the Government for doing it. Nothing will bring back their health, we know that. But on financial matters, which at least and to some extent might give them some security, I notice you've committed to reviewing the financial support schemes. Can you confirm that other UK countries will cooperate with that review, and if not, that Scotland will go ahead, as it has with this inquiry, with its own review?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say, first of all, that we have already initiated discussions that, certainly at official level, that we would want to begin to discuss the review of the financial arrangements on a UK basis, not least because the existing financial schemes are delivered on a UK basis. But as I said yesterday and again confirmed today to those affected and their families, that I am very, very clear that Scotland will not be held back if we can't reach agreement across these islands to move forward. I believe very strongly that we need to move forward. I hope that we can reach agreement across these islands, that should be the case across the four countries. But I'm also very, very clear that if we can't, then we will get on and do what's right for those here in Scotland.
Roger Grant, followed by Gil Paterson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I pay tribute to those who have campaigned and indeed still continue to campaign on behalf of those affected with this scandal? The Penrose Inquiry report highlights the issue of patient records and the fact that parts of some patient records are missing. And this causes a great deal of distress to patients and indeed suspicion that these were tampered with. Can I ask what the Cabinet Secretary is doing to address this and identify what happened to the records and why?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think the Penrose report looks into this in some detail and has gone through a lot of information around this. I mean, clearly, if there are other aspects of what Penrose has identified through his report, even if it's not translated into a recommendation, then there are things that you know, we would obviously be happy to look into. I think, though, that very much the focus and desire of those affected and their families is around the support going forward. And I think it is important that we focus our attention on that and what more we can do to make sure that people are supported. Yesterday, I heard some very difficult stories about the hardship that people are facing, that it had been made very difficult, more difficult than it should have been, for people to get some of the financial support, basic financial support, through the existing schemes. In my view, that is not good enough, and that should be our focus of attention going forward, and that will certainly be the priority that I give. Obviously, there are other matters, but I think we really should focus on the support requirements of those affected and their families.
Gil Paterson, followed by Malcolm Chisholm.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. Can I apologise to you and to the Cabinet Secretary for missing the earlier part of her statement? One of the main findings from the Penrose is that doctors at the time were very paternalistic and didn't give relevant information to patients. How can we be sure that this is no longer the case?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think very much through the Penrose report that comes across, that the relationship that people had with clinicians in not the 80s but the 70s and 80s was a paternalistic one, where consent and informed consent were not recognised in the way that they are recognised now, whether that was in relation to tests or test results. And we have moved a long way in the NHS now that is very much about recognising the patient's rights and their right and requirement to consent and for that to be informed consent. So I very much recognise the journey that the NHS has been on since then. And of course also the Patient Safety Programme has dealt with many of these matters and making sure that we have one of the world-leading patient safety programmes, and that is something that we should be proud of in our NHS of today, and recognise that we have come on a long journey since the days of the paternalism of the past.
Malcolm Chisholm, followed by Richard Lyle.
I can also pay tribute to the campaigners and acknowledge that the Cabinet Secretary and the First Minister have taken a close interest in this since the early days of the Scottish Parliament. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that an important part of the review has already been carried out by the Scottish Infected Blood Forum, with its HCV contaminated blood scoping exercise? Is the Cabinet Secretary minded to accept the recommendations of that exercise, remembering that one of the recommendations is that all the recommendations should be actioned within the lifetime of this Parliament?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think the work of the forum has been very important in giving us a really good starting point. The scoping work that they have done, it will be a useful starting point for the reference group. And we certainly discussed that today as being very helpful in making sure that the reference group can get underway and get on with the task in hand. And we'll certainly be using the work of the forum to do that.
Richard Lyle, followed by Jim Hume.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I thank the Minister for her statement and agree with all of her statement? As you will be aware, I've worked with Haemophilia Scotland over the last few years, and I pay tribute to the families and, in particular, to Bill Wright. Recently, I hosted a reception in this Parliament with a play portraying the disaster Factor 9. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if she will be requesting the Health Committee to discuss this report urgently, and if time can be allocated to discuss the report in the Chamber after any action by the Health Committee?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say that I also saw the play Factor 9. It was a very moving, very powerful play indeed, and you know, very, very powerful. The Health Committee obviously will be for the Health Committee to decide what they do, whether they want to seek to look at the report, and it's not for me to guide them in that respect, but I would certainly be very willing to make myself available to appear in front of the committee should they wish to have a look at the report, but also the work that's going to be happening thereafter in terms of the work of the reference group, and I certainly would make myself and my officials available for that. In terms of parliamentary time, again, I'd be very happy to make time available at the most appropriate moment to come back and revisit progress, perhaps around the reference group as we begin to take matters forward, and I could certainly keen to make sure that we keep Parliament well informed of the progress being made there.
Jim Hume, followed by Bob Doris.
Yeah, thank you. Can I first place on record my thoughts for the victims and families of those affected and their dignified campaign, and of course thank the Cabinet Secretary for advance sight of the statement. Presiding Officer, almost half of the people living with hepatitis C in Scotland are undiagnosed, and only about 3% of those receive treatment. The Hepatitis C Trust argue that it's a moral imperative that we find and diagnose these people before they develop advanced liver disease. I wonder what the government is doing to find those who need to be diagnosed and ensure that they're all provided treatment.
Cabinet Secretary.
A lot of work over the years has gone on to attempt to trace people, to find people who are not diagnosed in order for them to be offered a test and therefore to open up opportunities for treatment and support. Now, obviously, with the Penrose recommendation, there is an imperative upon us to see what more we can do in that respect, and we'll be discussing the best way of taking that forward so that, again, we can try to make sure that we pick up people who haven't already been diagnosed. And that's very, very important, because I'm sure, as Jim Hume knows, that there are now a very different set of drugs and treatments available than there was previously, and therefore getting people diagnosed and onto the most appropriate treatment is very, very important. So again, happy to keep Parliament informed of the work that we undertake to do that.
Bob Doris, followed by Joanne Lamont.
Cabinet Secretary, will the Scottish Government ensure that those living with Hep C due to contaminated blood get full and speedy access to a range of now curative medicines that have been developed recently? And can I also note that quite often the NHS doesn't prescribe some of those medicines until late stage Hep C, but the disease has been sitting within their bodies for a significant amount of time. So early access to curative medicines would be vital, I think, for many Hep C sufferers.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, can I say to Bob Doris, obviously these are clinical judgments, and someone would have to be clinically suitable for any drug or treatment. But with that caveat, then yes, I think it's very important that, particularly for those who have been affected through the infected blood and blood products, are given the opportunity to have those treatments. But again, they obviously have to be clinically suitable for those treatments, and that will be a clinical judgment.
John Lamont, followed by Sandra White.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Cabinet Secretary, I have a constituent whose husband was a haemophiliac who contracted hepatitis C through treatment and died young, having suffered immensely, not just from his condition, but from a fear of stigma that led to a desire for secrecy, which brought further burdens to him and to my constituent. My constituent hoped that Penrose would answer a simple question, and that was, why did it happen? And critically, whether people were infected after medically it was known that there was a serious problem with the contamination of blood. Could the Cabinet Secretary outline what her response is to that question,
And what now can people like my constituent do to feel that they have fought hard enough to secure justice for their loved ones?
Cabinet Secretary.
Can I say to Joanne Lamont that I recognise just the pain of her constituent and constituent's family, but many others. I met with many affected yesterday, and I was very struck by those personal stories and testament. One of the things Penrose did allow was for many of those, that testimony to be put on the record and recorded. Penrose also looked back into many of the issues that Joanne Lamont is referring to about what was known, what action was taken, what action wasn't taken. And it being an independent inquiry came to the conclusions that Penrose came to. But as I said in my opening statement, I recognise that for those affected and their families, for many of them, that those conclusions have not met with their expectations of what they wanted to see the Penrose report come up with. The best response I can give to that, and I think this is what those affected and their families want, is now to get on with the action required to support them in a better way. That was the message I got yesterday, the message I got today, and that is absolutely what I'm determined to do, because it is absolutely, I think, a moral obligation for us to make sure that those affected have the proper and adequate support to be able to get on with their lives in more comfort than they are at the moment. And that will be the focus of my attention over the next few weeks and months.
Sandra White, then finally Richard Simpson.
I just pay tribute to the many families, not just in the gallery, but throughout Scotland as well. Cabinet Secretary, given what we know happened in relation to HIV and Hep C, how can we be sure that the blood supply is safe from new infections which might now still emerge?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, as I said in my statement, the processes around blood donation and the treatment of blood and the safety of blood are very, very strictly controlled. And the message I would want to give today is that we have the one of the most safest processes and safest products here in Scotland and indeed in the UK throughout the world. And I think it's important that that message goes out, because I wouldn't want anyone who has been reading or listening to some of the really difficult issues around the Penrose report to be afraid of receiving blood or blood products here in Scotland, or indeed giving blood. I think it's really important that the message goes out that blood in Scotland is safe, and people should not be afraid to be a recipient of blood or blood products, or indeed, importantly, to give blood.
Richard Simpson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Would the Cabinet Secretary agree with me that this is the biggest medically caused tragic event since thalidomide, and indeed arguably bigger, and we should all regret the process taking so long? Even now, if more support beyond the ex gratia funding made by Labour is now put in place, many of the victims and their families may never have closure, nor the lives lost, of course, can never be restored. Cabinet Secretary, new medicine is rarely risk-free. So can she give us any indication as to whether we have a firm timetable for a no-fault compensation scheme?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think I said in my statement that this was one of the biggest tragedy that has faced our health service and those who were in receipt of treatment through our health service. I think I was clear about that in my statement. The issue, as I've said to others, about getting on with the review of the financial provisions and the method and the timescale for that hasn't been something I've decided upon. This has been in consultation with those affected, and they want to be involved in those discussions. They want to have ownership of those discussions, and they want that to be done in a proper process. And that's why what I announced in the statement has been really driven by those who have been affected. And I think it's absolutely critical that we listen to them. So the next step will be the reference group, and we've already had some discussions today about getting that underway. And then we'll begin the detailed discussions around those financial provisions and whether or not we can move forward with those on a UK basis or whether we need to do something in Scotland. And again, as I've said to others, I'm open-minded about that, and that will depend on the response from other parts of the UK. But what I am absolutely clear about is we will not stand back, and we will not stall from getting on with our moral duty to make the lives of those affected and their families better. That's what I'm going to be focused on over the next few weeks and months, to make sure we deliver that.
Thank you. That ends the statement from the Cabinet Secretary on the Penrose inquiry. Before we move to the next item of business, can I say to members that I allowed the statement to run on naturally to allow everybody who wished to ask a question to ask that question and to get an answer. That does mean that we're going to be very, very tight for time for the rest of the afternoon, so I hope you'll bear that in mind. So next item.